Hi, good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Good evening.
You can keep your microphones unmuted, but if you need to ask any questions, ask any time. I thought that I will actually share some experiences and some amount of technical information and knowledge with you all based on the discussion that we had the other day. And I thought that the foundation that Mitra laid in handling a very difficult subject, we need to take it to another level and to help you all to overcome any difficulties that are there in handling your gear. So what I'm trying to do today is to share with you some technical information and then show you some things that you can try out to do what you want to do. It is not essentially what I'm sharing or showing, but those are things that I like to do or we like to do. So you can try out various things, but let me get on with it. Please feel free to ask any question at any time, because it's easier to answer the question then and there rather than waiting for the last end of the session, because you might forget or I might forget. Okay, right. First thing that anyone who is using a flash, a speed light, something like this, needs to understand. I don't know whether you can see both screens at the same time. Can you? If you go and pin me, do you know how to pin? If you go to the gallery, and then look at my other screen and pin that, so that you will see both screens at the same time. Okay. All right. So first thing that we need to understand buying a flash is to understand how the numbering system works. Most of these flashes has a respective number. For example, Canon has 430EX, 580EX, 600EX, and a series like that, 270 and stuff like that. And it doesn't mean anything unless you know what the numbering defines or numbering is trying to tell you. Similarly, Nikon will have another series of numbers, Godox has another series of numbers, 685s, 520s, and things like that. But basically what it's telling you is the amount of light or the power that it has to throw out. Now, for example, if you take a 430EX, which I'm showing here, hopefully you can see it, it has a guide number 43. 43 is just a number still, but that number is coming from an equation that is based on physics and light. It's called the guide number. Guide number is the power that you can get based on the flash's capability. If you say the 430EX is basically 43 meters of light throw at F1, you will get a subject lit appropriately at that distance, at 43 meters. 43 is a guide number. Guide numbers are also referred to in meter form, as well as in the metric format, as well as in the imperial format. So just multiply it by the equivalent 3 point whatever, you get the equivalent feet. So for example, if you have a guide number of 40 on a flash, that means at F1, you can light up a subject 40 feet, 40 meters away. If it is given in meters, if it is given in feet, it is 40 feet. So don't get confused with the metric and the imperial system. And always this is measured at ISO 100. Okay, that's the first starting point. So if you have a flash which says 60 meters, at F1, you can throw light up to 60 meters. At F1, but we don't have lenses which are F1, so your capability is going to be much lower. Conversely, if you wanted to calculate the power or the aperture that you need with a guide number of 40 at a distance of 10, we'll say the guide number is given in meters or feet. If it is meters, at 10 meters, you need an F4 based on that equation. The equation is distance into aperture. at ISO 100. Okay, that's the first thing that you need to understand. Bit confusing at the beginning, but once you buy a flash, that flash is going to give you only that amount of power output. But you can step it down from the maximum of the full power to some has the capability of going down to 128th of the main the full power output in steps. Okay, so it will give you half the output, quarter output, 1/8 output, 1/16, 1/32nd, like that. It can go down to some can go up to 128th of the full power. Now, why that happens is when you throw light out, if the subject, the source is the blue dot here, as it goes further and further away, the light starts to fall off, or light starts to spread wider, and the area, if you take a measurement of, we'll say, this is the reference area, which is, we'll say, for example, 1 meter, the amount of light that you get here is going to be reduced if you increase the distance. If you double the distance, actually it is not going to halve, it is going to drop to 1/4, because the light fall off is based on a physics formula. It's the inverse square law. The distance squared is the amount that you're going to get, one over distance squared. If you double the distance, you get only 1/4. If you treble the distance, you get 1/9. Right? That's what's shown here in this pictorial diagram. Similarly, if you take a flash or a strobe or whatever, what you have at 100% is going to diminish very, very fast as you keep multiplying the distances. If at 2 it is 1/4, at thrice the distance it is 1/9, at 4 times the distance it drops to 1/16. So the light fall off is going to be very, very rapid as it the subject and the source are going to be spread apart. That is another fundamental thing that you need to remember. The closer you get, the better the maximum amount of light you get, but as you keep on doubling, it's going to go by reduced by the square of that distance that you are doubling or trebling or whatever that you are doing. Okay, same thing in a different format, just to illustrate how the light spreading and light is going to fall off. It's going to be more intense at the source, and as it keeps moving away and away, it's going to drop off. Then when you're using a flash, you might think that the flashes are interchangeable, or you can use it with other brands or other makes of cameras. Unfortunately, majority cannot be, because the connections are different. Now, if you look at now what I've shown here is the Canon cameras, three different models. If you look at the top of the camera, the hot shoe, there is a connection, set of connectors that are there. You see that there are 5 pins in the center here of the camera. Now, this is going to be different when it comes to other brands. And similarly, on the flash also, you have a corresponding connector to fit onto this, or a pin to connect to this connector. So it has to match so that it physically sits on top of each other. And also, because of the software that they are using, they cannot communicate even if they sit on top of each other. But something very interesting and important is that the center point is the one which actually fires the flash. The others are for radio communications and other communications that are happening between the camera and the flash. Now, if you are using there are two types of TTL. TTL stands for through the lens. There's ETTL and TTL. And then you get flashes which are not capable of TTL, or through the lens calculations. Now, this is on the left, you get the Canon flash pin connector types on the camera. And on the right, you get the flashes pins. Now, these are, as you can see, has to superimpose on each other to trigger it. When it comes to the other brands, Laya will have to probably help me here to explain the differences in the pin connectors. I have put some pictures here of the different types of connectors that are available on different brands. So you can see that they are not going to work with each other if it's connected on top of the camera. Okay. Recently, Canon did something very interesting. They took away the center pin. This is one of the very recent Canon camera hot shoe mount. And you can see that inside that red circle, the center pin is missing. The reason for them to do that is to prevent or to encourage Canon users to use Canon original flash guns, which in a way is good for them. But in a way, it is, I personally don't think it's the right move in the right direction, because these type of cameras are cheaper than some of the Canon flashes. So no one who is spending, we'll say 70,000-80,000 rupees is going to spend a 90,000 rupees to buy a flash which is going to work with this. And anyway, the Chinese didn't take too much time to overcome that barrier. They have now come up with software patches to update their firmware on the flashes that they have, they're selling and sold, so that they are back again compatible with the Canon flashes. Now, this is the underside of the flash of a Canon camera. This is going, as I told you, that it's going to be different in the other brands. But if you buy a flash which is Canon compatible, then the underside is going to look the same. It can be with a metal plate like what is shown on the right here, or a plastic plate as seen on the left. These two flashes which I have here with me are the identical flashes, the 430EX and the 580EX. One has a metal, one has a plastic. Then Canon has a range of flashes, and they also have a trigger. Now the one on the left is called a transmitter. Sometimes we call it a trigger, we call it a transmitter. Some of the flashes, Canon flashes included, they have a built-in radio function. The built-in radio function is for us to be able to remotely trigger that flash using a transmitter or a trigger. If you use compatible equipment, you can actually control the power output, the mode what it's working on, and a host of other things using one of these transmitters. And even the it works with TTL, it works with multi and regular, the manual mode. And also using the camera's menu also, you can actually send information out to the flash. So it's, if you use the correct transmitter, and if you have a flash which has the built-in receiver, then they will start to communicate with each other. If not, you can always trigger these in the slave mode using optical triggering. Optical triggering is, these flashes have a capability of detecting a sudden impulse or sudden pulse of lighting, and based on that, it can trigger itself. It's just to give a light output. You cannot control the power output from the camera, but manually you have to adjust the power of the individual flashes. Now, something very interesting with these triggers is that they also allow you, in some cases, going up different, five different groups or three different groups, and up to five flashes in each group. Not that we will ever use it, but the capability is there to group flashes up to five into each group, and some triggers allow you to group up to five such groups. So in total, either 15 or 25 flashes can be triggered at the same time. Professional photographers would obviously do that. Now, when it comes to third-party flashes, there are third-party flashes which are available, which are compatible with Canon or the other brands. If you're buying, we'll see, now what I've shown here are the Godox flashers, two different versions of that. Godox has a pretty wide range from the very basic, the TT522, which is shown on the right, which comes with its own trigger, and it's a manual flash. The flash is not TTL, in other words. You have to set the power output, but it has the slave capability, either using the transmitter and the receiver, which is built in, or you can also trigger it optically using another flash. Now, if you look at the bottom of this, there will be only that center pin. It's not going to contain the five different pins that were there on the flash that I showed you earlier. The 685C, TT685, is a flash which is with a built-in receiver, but it doesn't come with a trigger. Using a trigger, you can also control this. All the capabilities can be made use of. I'll show you a similar trigger that can be used and control it similarly like what I showed you with the Canon flash. Now, this has full auto capability or TTL capability. The one on the right cannot. Now, something that you have to be very careful in buying third-party flashers, as I said, is the compatibility issue. The compatibility because of the connectors. The second thing is the compatibility of the software. If you're buying for Nikon, make sure that you buy, now this TT685 comes in four or five different versions. 685C is for Canon, 685N is for Nikon, 685F is for Fuji, I think 685S is also there for Sony, and they have a series like that. So you have to make sure you buy the correct version of that identical flash if you're using a different brand to suit your brand. Now the version 522 is compatible with some of the flashes, some of the other cameras, because it has only the single pin. With that, you can trigger it off. Now, for example, this can be used, the TT520 can be used both on Nikon and Canon, but I'm not sure whether it works on Sony because the pin connectors are located differently. Then you get the transmitters and the receivers. There are two types now involved. Earlier I showed you the transmitter. Now it is, they have the transmitter plus the receiver. On the left top, you find the X1TC, which is the transmitter for Canon, and the other one is X1R, which is the receiver. Now, if you connect the X1T on a Canon camera and you have a flash which is not having a built-in receiver onto this, which is compatible with Canon onto the receiver, then you can make use of the full functionality of both the camera and the flash using this device. Once again, here you get in the center, you see the control panel. And with that, through the unit itself or through the camera, you can send signals out to the flash to control the flash's output. These are tiny little devices, things like this, small devices. And the receiver doesn't have I hope you can see it. The receiver doesn't have any connections. It's only the connections are here on the top where the flash is going to be connected. This is just a cold shoe mount. The other one is a hot shoe mount. This is the transmitter. Transmitter has the hot shoe. And transmitter also has the capability of having another flash on top of this. So that's one type. Then you get a host of other brands, like Aperture and Fotix and all sorts of people who are doing these things. But once again, they are dedicated to work with a particular brand. Now, what I have shown here, the top left is Canon. This top, the bottom left is Nikon. Bottom right is for Fuji. Top right is for Sony. So there are different identical thing but different versions for the different brands.
Sam, sorry, can I interrupt for a
minute? Go ahead.
Yeah. Sam, now I have this this top X1T thing on the
okay.
I don't have the X1R.
Okay.
But my flash is a Godox TT350. So
yeah, I can't remember whether the 350 has the built-in receiver. If it has the built-in receiver, you don't need the X1R.
Yeah, the receiver does what?
Receiver is for flashes which do not have a built-in receiver. Say, for example, my 430 EX here, it's a Canon flash. This doesn't have a built-in receiver.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? But if I wanted to fire this remotely, I can always connect it with the X1R, which is a receiver, fix this onto that, and shoot it.
All right. So anyway, I'm able to shoot remotely. So that means
you have the receiver there.
It
has the built-in receiver.
Right.
I can't
right, sorry, sorry.
The
yeah, yeah. I've been doing that. I didn't realize all this what receiver.
Okay. So this is what is happening. I'm actually trying to answer some of your questions that came up the other day. These are the terminology that is being used. Even the 580 EX, which I've been using for some time, doesn't have a built-in receiver. So if I want to trigger this through radio, then I have to connect it with a receiver and then get the transmitter to send the signals out, pulses out. Okay. Any questions up to now, other than anything? Or Laya, is there anything that you want to add, please?
Well, just one little caution, and I mean, you made actually it very amply clear that you need to actually get these compatible versions. Now, just to let you know that in the olden days, there used to be Vivitai and those who can remember, and Mercs, and then there are a whole host of other flash guns. Now, recently I have seen at eBay and various places, these things going at dirt cheap.
Okay.
Now, one of the reasons is because these older flash guns used to work with the normal cameras, which had only a mechanical connector. And these flash guns actually throw out round about hundreds of volts for their trigger.
Okay.
So don't be tempted to go and buy these cheaper ones, because if you put that one into your camera, that's going to fry it.
Okay.
So keep away from these very cheap ones. They're pretty good if you know how to use them.
Yep.
So you got to have a compatible, what you call a receiver, that can actually take these large voltages and with just a mechanical connect, the contact for them to work. I have two Vivitas with me, and that's the way I use them. So be careful.
Thanks. Yeah, thank you. Somebody was going to ask a question. I don't know who it was. There was another question coming up. Some lady spoke. Couldn't pick who it was. Was it Diandi or?
No, not me.
Ah, okay. Right. Then,
Sam, I got a question.
Yes.
Sam, it's Sean. Sam, do all these Godox flashes work optically as well, or do we have to set it to some way to work it like that?
You have to set them because if you go through your product manual, you will find that there is S1 and S2, that is slave 1 and slave 2 in Godox flashes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I think it is S2, if I'm not greatly mistaken, for optical flashing.
Okay, I'll try that. Thanks.
Okay, right. All these flashes also have all sorts of additional features. You have to, that's another half a day session if we were to go through all the capabilities of flashers. The three main things that you need to know is that there is a TTL mode or an ETTL mode, which is the automatic mode. In the automatic mode, the camera and the flash talk to each other. When you take a picture, the flash emits a, a certain amount of light, which we probably don't see. We don't see actually. It flashes out, and then the camera picks up the information as to how much light has been thrown out and what's the amount that is coming back. There's a lot of calculations that is going through the system, and that is how the camera and the flash can give you the required power output when you're on auto mode. Okay, but when it comes, then there are two other modes, what is known as the manual mode and the multi-mode. Multi-mode is for more artistic special effects, but the one that you have to master more than the even the automatic mode is the manual mode. How to use your flash in manual mode. When it comes to flashes, there is certain things that you have to understand, that your camera also has a certain role to play. I'll come to that in a moment, but remember that when you go into manual mode and set your camera's shutter speeds and all that, there is a certain information that you have to know about your camera to set it correctly. Well, the other area that thing that we need to know about is using our strobes. Maybe all of us don't have the strobes, but getting to know the strobe is also good. Strobes don't have the guide numbers as the flashers are, but it is much more versatile in the sense that it has more power, and also more. All these things come with a modeling lamp. Now the set that I have is the Elinchrom D-Light RX4. It has any of the flashers will have the modeling lamp and the flash tube. The modeling lamp is for us to visualize what is going to happen, because it can be set to proportionately light your subject so that you get a rough feeling of where the light is actually falling and whether you need to make any adjustments. At the back of the flash, you get controls. Most of the flashes will work from it has an up-down button, and the digital display or the manual display, manual controller will take it from 1 to 6. It's a 6-stop adjustment, and you get decimal points as well in between numbers. So you can set the largest number that you see is the maximum power output, the full power, and then proportionately it drops to either 1/32 or 1/16 of the power output. Then all these can be, the modeling lamp, as I said, can be set to proportionate lighting. That is to say that if you are putting full power output on your flash tube, the modeling lamp will also put out full power, but the power output is much lower, but it will give you a proportionate lighting output. They also have the capability of actually being triggered off the light or the opticals as an optical slave. The white button that you see here, which will be somewhere else in a different model, is the light pickup sensor. And it can play a music to say that it has fully charged and all that jazz is there. Then some of them can be remotely controlled, some of them can't be. Now the set that I have comes with a what is called a Skyport radio trigger. Once again, a small device like this, which sits on top of the camera, but at the back of it, there's only one pin, which means that I can only trigger the flash, but I cannot control the power output from the camera or the trigger. So whatever the adjustments that I have to do has to be done at the flash or the strobe head itself. Now, something that I said I will come to later is about the three, four different things that you need to understand and be familiar with. One is the what is called the sync speed of your camera. Each camera brand and models will have different sets of numbers. It can range from, I think, 1/60th of a second, going up to some can go up to about 250th of a second. So that will be the fastest speed at which your camera can work perfectly with a flash. It's called the sync speed. Now, if you look at the picture here, the slow, do you see the bottom part of this picture here? What happens is you have your shutter closed when you start, and then the front curtain drops down and exposes the entire sensor at a particular moment in time for a short duration. And then the rear curtain comes down and closes the shutter, the sensor. Now, unless you flash, though the flash duration, flash is much faster duration, it only fraction of a second, it's much faster than the shutter speed. But unless it flashes at this correct moment in time where the sensor is fully open, remember, unless it is triggered at the time that this sensor is fully open, it is the sensor is not going to get properly illuminated, or the subject is not going to be properly exposed. Right? The normal flash actually triggers when this happens. Right? What the on the right here, I have shown some pictures how the shutter speed and this sync speed correspond or relate to each other, and then what happens. We'll say your camera's shot in this particular case, the sync speed is 200th of a second for this particular camera. So anything slower than that, from 80th of a second to 100, 125, 160th and 200th, it's okay because the synchronization is happening correctly. But the moment you go, the moment you go beyond that, part of your the curtain has now already started to cover the sensor. So there is going to be a little bit of a banding that is going to happen. And then it gradually keeps on increasing until you don't get anything. Okay, so if you find that when you're on manual mode and you set your shutter speed at a particular speed, you get a banding, a black band appearing, that means your shutter speed and your sync speed are not matching. This happened mostly when you trigger a flash off camera. Because on camera, most of the cameras today, actually, the moment you fix a flash, it locks down the shutter speed to the sync speed. So you have to be careful. If you see this banding happening, this is what the problem is. Then if you wanted to capture action, which is faster than your sync speed, these cameras have what is called a high speed sync. When you use a faster shutter speed than the sync speed and set your camera and the flash to work on high speed synchronizing, the flash not only fires once, but it fires several times, not once, during this front curtain and the rear curtain opening and closing. Is that clear? Because if you, hello?
Yeah. It's a burst of flashes.
It's a burst of flashes. It's a multiple flashes, but what you get is only one single picture. Okay. Then the other day, Mitra mentioned that he was shooting at 1/120th or 1/115th of a second, and the shutter speed does not matter. It is true because the flasher speed is much faster than the shutter speed. So whatever speed you have for your shutter, the exposure is going to be the same. But remember, the slower your shutter speed, there is a chance that the subject can slightly move, and there can be slight movement. And if you want to actually go for very slow shutter speeds, you have to switch your camera to rear curtain syncing rather than the front curtain syncing. That is also capable both on flashes and on the camera. So you have to understand these differences and the different nuances of this terminology and the functionality to correctly master your Flash. Okay?
So that
yes.
only affects if there is any ambient light captured on this thing. No?
Yeah, if there is ambient light.
Otherwise, there won't be any.
If it is completely dark, I don't think. But still, there could be if you have the modeling lamp working.
If the modeling lamp is on,
there could be slight movement that may be visible, may not be even visible.
I have experienced that the eyes sometimes not get sharp enough because of the modeling lamp. So what I do switch off the modeling lamp, but I can go as low as on the shutter speed because the flash is like 1/10,000th of a second duration.
Yes. Flash is going at, much faster speed than the shutter does.
I have a question. So why does the... Now you said that... at lower shutter speeds, that the rear curtain is a better way to actually sync the flash. But even if you use the rear curtain as a flash, both curtains are going to be open for a little while, and the same problem that mine mentioned can be there. So why is the rear curtain
The rear curtain is recommended if you're going on, for example, on Canon. If you're shooting anything slower than 1/25th of a second, they recommend to use the rear curtain. So maybe with different
brands.
The reason is,
Sam, I have tried this, right? What happens is now if you use the flash or the front curtain, whatever the motion blur that is going to come from the ambient light is going to be after the flash exposure.
Yeah.
Okay. Right. So it will be visible on the image. But if you have the ambient that blur earlier, and if you have the flash at the rear curtain, the image that gets from the flash exposure gets kind of superimposed on that blurry area and makes it look sharper.
Oh, really?
But it is only working for very slight movements, like let's say the eyelids going down, something like that. It's if the model is like seriously moving around, that will not cover it. But the slight movements. It will come.
Yeah. I have done also, a similar thing.
I have seen that in the Nikon. Sorry. Go ahead,
Mitra. Go ahead.
Yeah, I have done a similar thing where the modeling lamp is used to show a slow. A curtain going across, a normal curtain going across on a model, and the model is stationary. There's a blur on the curtain, so the light is from the modeling lamp is captured on the curtain, so it gives a nice effect. You can create effects like that.
Okay, and also this front curtain and rear curtain is used. When you're shooting light trails, if you use the front curtain, you will find the light coming in the front of a vehicle, for example. The rear curtain, you get it in the rear after the subject. So you can try out these. These are, artistic experimental kind of stuff that you can try out with your flashes. Interesting things to do. Now you might ask, now Mitra, when he did the presentation, he used a light meter. Now somebody might ask whether light meter is an essential part of your toolkit if you're using flashes. My personal opinion is no. The reason is because you cannot trigger these flashes with the light meter, whereas the light meter can trigger our strobes, and you can get a reading of the strobes. If you're using studio lights, having a light meter would be a very good useful tool, but even without that you can try out, because today the cost of exposure is nothing.
Also, your camera has a light meter built in, so
it has a built-in light meter, so you can always work it out. So anyway, but you can still, if you, I'm just trying to answer a potential question whether you need a light meter, okay? Just to show you, illustrate the way of the shutter mechanism work, this is for a focal plane shutter on a DSLR. Mirror up, comes up, this goes down, the second one comes, and then closes. But when it comes to the mirrorless, it's a different thing because your sensor is always open and then closed and exposed again. Right. Now we come to the interesting stuff. I say interesting because there are different ways that people look at how studio lighting or photography with lighting is to be done. Each one has his or her interests and likings and dislikes. So we will try to show you what we did, and you are free to ask any questions as to how we did it, but I'm not going to shoot, but I'm going to show you the effects of these things. We'll now, this set was done by Kaumini using bust of a Nefertiti. She can probably explain that. We will show it to you.
So this is the bust of the Nefertiti that I used, and of course it Sam's Elinchrome strobe.
Right. Okay. Before that, what we did was we actually kept it on a background, which was black. In fact, I actually opened, hang on to this one. What we used was a box like this. This is a product shoot box that I have. What I did was I actually turned it upside down and used it like this. But for today's, what I'm going to show you today, what I'm going to show you is, I'm going to keep that as the, for the on the top of the table, so that I don't get any brown color from the table coming up, and I'm using a reflector at the back so that the back is also completely dark. The reason was we wanted to get it to be in a dark background, kind of a low-key effect. Now, to visualize what happens when the light is falling on this subject, I'm going to switch off some of the lights and show you what it does. Lights, you know? I'm going to use a basic, you know, a ceiling lamp, right? This is what temporarily I'm going to use to show you. Now, if I light it from the front, this is overexposed completely because the power is too much. You will see the front lighting. And if I light it from the side, it only lights up one side of it. So you have to start visualizing how the light is going to affect your subject by placing the light in different directions of positions and angles. Okay? Now, this is one of the key things that you have to understand. So what we did, this can be easily done with the flash as well, but what we used was my Elinchrome lamp, which we kept like this. The reason for bringing it closer was to make sure that we use the lowest amount of light, and there's very limited light that is going to go beyond the subject so that the whole subject becomes dark. Now, if I light it up from here, then it's going to actually only light up to the center here, because the light is coming from this direction. The subject is facing this direction. The camera was here, right in front. So we are, the light and the camera are at 90 degree angles.
It's lighting.
right?
So Sam, what kind of lens did you use? Because doesn't the lens get interrupted by the light source so close to the subject?
No, Malaya, what we did was, I'm coming to that, what I used, what we used the other, that particular day is a Canon 7D Mark II with a 24 millimeter f2.8 lens. Okay?
Yeah.
And what I did first was to meter this to get, if I took a picture without the light, I was just getting a pitch black picture.
Right.
Nothing was going to be, registered on the sensor, completely dark. And then I started lighting up to get the effect that we wanted. So if I meter it now and take it, but basically I put it into manual mode, the flash was, the shutter speed was set to 1/200th of a second, which is the sync speed. The aperture, I took it down to, I think, f16 or f11, so that I reduce the amount of light that is coming through and reduce the ISO to the basic 100 ISO, so that the ISO is the lowest, shutter speed was the sync speed, the highest sync speed that I could get on this, and the aperture was as small as possible to make sure that I don't get anything registered with the ambient light. Okay? And yeah. Then when I flash it, the flash is the one that is going to give you the exposure to the picture. Did I answer your question, Laya?
Yeah.
Okay. So now, right now, this is set to the lowest light. Anyone? I don't know whether you can see it.
Yeah.
Okay. So gradually, when I start increasing the light, proportionately, it starts to light up. Okay. And then what we did was, while keeping the light and the camera at the same positions, 90 degrees to each other, we started turning the subject. And then the lighting is going to, now from here, it is going to actually create kind of a Rembrandt site of a triangle on the cheek. And then if you keep it like this, it's going to be a split. Only half of the face is going to be lit. So we tried different angles, different things. Fortunately, or luckily, because of the strobe, we could get to see before we shot the image what kind of effect we were going to get. Whereas on a flash, that's an unfortunately a disadvantage that you have, because you cannot visualize what is going to happen with the lighting. But with trial and error, by adjusting your power output or your flash output, and also your shutter speeds and your apertures, you can try out. After a couple of shots, you can end up with a picture like this. Now, we took different angles. We took she took pictures from this angle directly. Yeah, different pictures were taken so that the same subject. Now, the idea here, now, if we were to completely light this up and take a picture, anyone can take the picture. But the idea here was to get pictures that were different, kind of artistic, and also gives a kind of a moody effect or a mood that is different to the standard pictures that one would take. So when you do take pictures of subjects, still life, you have to look at the profiles, you have to look at the shapes, you have to look at the different ways that it can be lit to highlight the subject, rather than highlight the important salient areas, but not to take a full blast of light onto the subject and get a standard regular picture. Now, you will start to see, this is something very, very important for you to start to see these highlight areas. Once you start to see that, that's what you want to capture in the picture. At least that is what we try to do. Okay, so it's a trial and error. It's something that you have to keep on trying to achieve what you want to show, rather than just taking a picture of a subject. Any questions there? I'm not going to take pictures and show you because it's the settings were 200th of a second f/16 and ISO 100. Camera was the 70 Mark II with a 24 millimeter f/2.8 lens. Pictures are taken handheld.
Sam, just a question.
Yes. Here, mine.
Now, the other day I just tried something after the first session with Mitra. Now they are like you said, because I used a flash till the picture came, you don't know what it is. So,
yes.
What now in a scenario like this, would you for a object, would you always use a fixed light? What is this thing called? It's a studio light.
These are studio lights or strobes. These are called studio lights or strobes.
So they are continuous light. No, they are not triggered by.
No.
Continuous light.
They have a modeling lamp, which I showed you there earlier in the slideshow. It has a modeling lamp. The modeling lamp is the one that is lighting now. But if I trigger it, it's going to give me a flash output like that.
These things also can be triggered. Now, when you took your camera, when you took the picture, it triggered the
it triggers the flash.
Now I got it.
This is used to visualize.
Okay.
The modeling lamp is used to visualize, and then once you got your angles and your lighting directions and all that right, you actually take the picture while triggering the flash, then it triggers like a flash normally. It triggers like a normal flash.
Okay, sorry. I'm very new to this.
Ask questions because it is important to understand the fundamentals here, right?
As the lighting, the light meter has a you can measure the flash output. You keep the modeling, the light meter at the subject and measure the flash output, not the modeling light output, but the flash output.
Yeah, if I have a light meter, I will keep the light meter facing towards the light and trigger it, and then the flash will actually pop. Flash will pop and gives the this will pick up the information, the light meter, and tell me what aperture and what shutter speed to use.
Mahin, one of the things that Sam said was that with the modeling light, he set the camera to f/16 and 1/200. In effect, the camera does not register anything from the modeling light. The modeling light is faint.
Yes, yeah. It's very low power.
Low power, faint, and so the flash, the photography is taken with the flash only.
Right, I got it.
Right, and also something I said earlier is the light fall off. Now, if you measure the distance from here to here, and then the distance which I am standing here, which is about the double the distance to this, if this gets 100% light, I'm only going to get, because the distance is doubled, I'm going to get only 25% of the light. The further away I go, it keeps on reducing. So the idea here is that one is that by keeping it at this direction and the camera in this direction, nothing from this is going to spill anywhere else, which the camera is going to pick up. The light is going to go this way. This is a dark background and camera is there. So therefore, there is nothing going to interfere with my exposure. So I'm able to get a pretty dark background, but the subject is lit the way that I want it to light. Okay. Now with a flash, what you could do, now if you are using a flash, like we'll say, for example, you have this flash, if you use it directly on this, it's going to be very harsh. When I say harsh, it's this is another thing that you need to understand. When the light is smaller, when the source is smaller, it is going to be very, very hard lighting or harsh lighting. it's going to create very hard edges in separating the light and the shadow areas. Whereas when you have a larger light, although the light, the flash tube is small, by having a softbox like this, in effect, it is creating a much larger surface area for the light to come out from. And therefore, it becomes a larger light source. If you can visualize when the sun is on a clear day, sun is out on a clear day, it's very hard lighting. But a few minutes later, if you get a good cloud cover coming through, then it makes it softer because the light becomes to kind of get spread through that the cloud cover, and it makes it softer. It gets kind of diffused. So if you're using a flash, try and use something in front of this to make this larger or to make it softer, to make it diffused. You can use different things like, for example, the cheapest one would be an umbrella. The cheapest one would be an umbrella. If you flash it through the umbrella, then what happens is this becomes the light source, the larger light source rather than this smaller light source. But the umbrella gives a fairly decent diffused light. Otherwise, you can go for things like even a softbox, like a softbox like this. A softbox, which is, now this is a 60 by 60 centimeter light box, a softbox. You insert your flash through this and lock it up, mount it on a light stand, and then trigger it. Still, the disadvantage of not being able to visualize is there. So what you could try perhaps is to use a continuous light source like a table lamp or whatever you have at home, even a ceiling lamp that I showed you earlier, and light your subject to see how the light plays on this. And if you find it, that this is spreading too much, for example, this light is very, very harsh. This light is very, very harsh. Even this light, you can actually make it softer by lighting through this. Other than this, you can make it this, right? And if it is spreading all over the place, you can improvise, use even a box so that you direct the light only through that box to come out. I just actually did it yesterday to see how it works, using one of the cardboard boxes that we had at home. So it's another. Sandy. Just give me a moment. I'm trying to show you that as well.
Mahin, you actually mentioned that you are actually using bounce flash. That one of the things that you are doing with the bounce flash is actually increasing that surface area of the light out of from the ceiling or somewhere else, so that it actually becomes softer.
I think Sandeep mentioned that. No,
Was it Sandeep?
Yeah.
No.
Somebody mentioned it. Yeah, I thought
someone did mention it. Yeah.
Okay.
I just used this cardboard box and inserted it into this, and then I can direct the light the way I want it without it spilling all over the place. So you can improvise on these things until you get the hang of it before you invest in equipment, because we can buy all the equipment that we have in the world, but first you have to know what to do with it. Right, this is one set of lighting that we did. As I said, we were having a 90 degree angle between the light source and the subject. The second one was actually, now if I took a regular picture of this subject, it would have looked like this. This is the subject. And I don't know whether you can see it. It's about 12 to 14 inches tall. If I took a normal picture with the flash, the one that I'm showing, sharing on the screen is what I would get. But what we did was to, once again, look at the contours, look at the profiles, look at the way the subject had been lit, and experimented to get certain interesting effects or views of the subject. Once again, it was the same thing here with the light at 90 degrees, pretty close to the subject, and then started to adjust the angle. And then you start to see where it starts to, the profiles are going to be seen, the shapes are going to be visible, where the light is going to fall, rather than just taking a straightforward picture. So any subject that you take, any eye product that you shoot, look at how the light is going to create different angles or different views of the same subject, rather than just taking a front on picture. And another thing that I actually would like to suggest is that if you're taking, when you're starting off at least, start with a single subject rather than taking a group of subjects and trying to light it up, because the moment you have multiple items, there's going to be shadows that are going to be cast on the second subject and the third subject, and it keeps on adding on to the shadowy areas, and that's not going to be very aesthetic or pleasing to the eye. So select a subject, single subject, and then light it up. If you have, I think Laya tried out the pine cones with the cup. Isn't it, Laya?
Yeah, right.
Yeah, so instead of that, if you tried the cup itself,
yeah,
you probably can light up the rim of it, the handle. It actually really looked very nice with the Ceylon tea or whatever on that. So you can try out different things.
Yeah.
Right. So rather than taking, because the moment you put five pine cones, you don't know which one to focus on.
Right.
Right. So try that, and keep trying, because without trying you cannot get the hang of it. Then the third one I did was this. It's a black vase with a artificial orchid on it. Okay. If I took the entire profile, that still would have looked nice. But what I wanted to get was these shapes. And the light to just, you know, brush off that or kiss the surface only and get the profile to come into play rather than showing the entire thing. Light any other? Any move?
And this is also having a good lesson.
Come again?
I said Sandy is also learning a lot today.
Oh, you mean the dog?
Yes.
Ah, wow. He'll become a good flash photographer.
He looks super curious.
Sam, I think you're on mute. We can't hear you.
Am I audible now?
Yeah.
Ah, okay, sorry. Okay, what I was trying to say is that look at the shapes, look at the profiles, and look at how the highlight of the light is coming out in your picture. And then if it's a, you know, if it's something like this, you can keep on turning it to see how to get it. But then the challenge was to actually, I needed to get the flower and also the part of this profile. But my intention was not to make it completely visible, but to make it kind of a mysterious kind of looking thing. So I actually increased the height of the light, raised the light like this, and then angled it down so that this gets more light. And because of the light fall off, what is going to come here is much less. So that final effect was the one that I showed you right at the beginning. I think it was there right at the beginning of the slideshow. This is what I got. Rather than showing the entire picture of the vase. So these are things that I actually wanted to share with you. And more importantly, about the sync speed and the technical stuff that I wanted to clear certain doubts or questions that you may be having. So basically that covers what I wanted to show, but are there any questions or clarifications or any things that you want to ask me right now or us?
Sam, regarding yes. Outdoor photography with yes. flash. Now, yes. There is a instance like you can't use slave mode, right? Sometimes if you're using flash with the slave mode, due to the light intensity of natural light, sometimes the flash doesn't work.
When you say slave mode, you're looking at the optical slave mode, is it?
Yeah.
Optical slave mode sometimes might not work.
It doesn't work, yeah. So you have to go might for wireless.
It depends on the location. Depends on the location, whether the... Because as I showed you, some of these flashes have the light pickup on the reverse of it. Now, this particular one...
That's a problem.
It's on the back of it. So depends on where the optical cell is.
And also the flash gun, there's a particular place where the safe unit will pick up. If it doesn't show the light striking to that point, it will flash. So those are things people have to look out for.
These flashers have their own pickup cells. I think somewhere here. I don't know where it is.
That is a disadvantage sometimes.
Not on this. This is in the front. It's on the front here. Now this also has in the front here. It's here. I don't know whether you can see it. It's a small cell there. Sandeep, I managed to actually use Sandeep. Are you there?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah, I managed to use the trigger X1 trigger on the Fujifilm. Uh-huh. It managed to trigger it. There was a communication between the.
X1 trigger on the Fujifilm, is it?
X1 Canon trigger on the Fujifilm.
Uh-huh.
I managed to trigger that. I don't know how it worked. Just to pop the flash at least.
But in manual mode, yeah?
In manual mode. Nothing.
In manual?
Yeah.
Yeah. So I have used my Nikon triggers now. I used to shoot Nikon. So those flashes I can still use with my Fuji. Manual flash only uses that power pin. The middle
center. Yeah, the center pin only. Yeah, as long as the center pin is there, you can do it. Somebody else was asking a question. I'm sorry.
Sam, I was asking about the flash mounts. If we are going to buy a softbox, they advertise things like Bowen and other types. Are there different types, or should we? Is there anything that we should be
worried about? If you are looking for softboxes for flashers. Right? Flashers, the Bowens mount is not the Bowens mount that you're talking about. you now this is called an S bracket on a Godox flash softbox. It's a let me remove it. This is the Bowen's. It's actually what is called a S bracket, where you insert your flash through this and lock it up. The softbox sits on this. Okay.
Okay.
Bowen's mount is also built into this, so that if you are going to use a regular softbox, which is meant for studio lighting, then the Bowen's mount is already built into this. There are different types of mounts, so you have to be careful in selecting the correct type of mount if you have studio lights. Now, what I have is the Elintrom. Elintrom mount is different. Elintrom only has two slots where the thing gets connected. Now this has three, the Bowen's mount. Similarly, there are different mounts that are there. So yes, you have to be careful.
So it depends on the strobe or the, so in that case, it is a...
If it is a strobe, you have to first find out what the strobe mounts are. And from there, expand on your equipment.
So in any day, it will be a S-type bracket.
No, Godox has this S-type brackets. Now this is the S-type version 1. There's a newer one which has come out called S2. These are for flashers. But the mount is also built into this, because you can then Godox has a range of accessories. Some of those accessories can be used on this.
Oh, good. Got it. Thanks.
The one that Sam showed is actually the Bowen's mount version of the S bracket.
Yes. Wow. This one is the Bowen's mount bracket.
So, Laya, that's the adapter that I said I'm using with my speed lights for my softboxes. So, with this adapter, I can put the flash and combine it with my Bowen's mount softboxes.
Okay. All right. There's something else that Sam worth saying. I don't know how many are Nikon users and they actually have Nikon speed lights. Now, one of the things that you could do with the Nikon camera, I guess you could do that with the Canon too, is that that you could actually, let me show you that you can actually open up the little light here, and this now becomes the transmitter. So you can actually place your speed lights outside anywhere. And if you actually use it in the commander mode, the camera, then this one actually communicates with the speed lights using some non-seen flash lights just before the flash gun is goes off. And then so the camera knows the exposure settings and everything from the flash. And all the flashes can go. So as you said, you could actually group the flashes and send it. Yeah. Or you could use this SU capability that Mitra was talking about. Now, the SU might not work outside, but the commander mode works outside.
Yeah.
So you can actually have modeling flashes outside using this one. So this actually works as the transmitter. So you don't as have I to said, buy a separate transmitter if you have a Nikon system.
As I said, Naya, like you can main flash gun on the camera, you can reduce the power down so that the light doesn't strike in front. And you can use the others as the main flash.
Correct. So that's lights. What I do. I completely write it down to minus 0.7 EV. So basically, there's hardly any light out of this. But I actually use the light from the flash guns that I have outside to illuminate the subject.
Okay, Laya, I think the newer Canon cameras also have a capability where the flash doesn't actually pop. But it can send the command to slaves or flashes which are kept externally to trigger them. Now, I am not really sure how it works, but I believe it is based on another small technical thing that is happening, there is a pre-flash.
Yeah, maybe infrared.
Yeah, no, there is a pre-flash that is sent out. That is the one that is used for TTL or ETTL. Yeah. Pre-flash to measure the lighting. Now, using that, you can always trigger the external flashes. Now, having spoken about that, I also must warn whoever is using studio lighting. If you are using studio lighting and then trying to use the trigger on TTL mode, it is not going to work.
It will not work.
It is not going to work. The reason is the strobe is going to trigger on the pre-flash.
Pre-flash.
Right? Not on the correct timing. Right. So you will get an underexposed. It is not good for both. The picture is going to be underexposed.
So what the lesson there is that the speed lights and the strobes don't always work together in the same way that we think it will.
It will work if you're on manual mode, not on TTL.
Yeah.
You cannot do it on TTL.
And rear-sync.
Yes. Rear-sync. Yeah.
If you're on rear-sync, it will work. Without having the pre-flash.
Sandeep has added something to the chat box. He says that S1 and S2, the difference is S1 turns on the optical slave, and S2 turns the optical slave but ignores the pre-flash. Same thing that we were discussing now. I think he's answering Ishan's question earlier. Ishan, I think he was asking about whether you can use on a optical slave mode.
Yeah, sir. That's very good to know.
Yeah. So he Sandeep has answered that in the chat box as well. Varna, are you there? Ah, yes. Varna.
Yes, I'm here. I mean, there are lots to get in. I'm not a flash photographer at all. I'm
hopefully this. I hope this was useful.
It was useful, absolutely. Learned a lot.
Another interesting thing to add, Sam.
Yes.
If you do not have a black background, you can take into account the fall off of the light because of this inverse scalar, right? But if you have enough distance between your subject and the background, you can actually turn it completely black.
Yeah. You can.
The light will not fall into enough to expose anything on the background if you have enough distance.
Yeah, what he's saying is that when you have the subject here and there's fair amount of distance from here to the background, the light fall off is going to make it, it'll die off. So virtually nothing is going to be captured on your picture.
That's obviously only if you're taking it in the night, right?
No, during the daytime also. Even during the daytime, you can do it.
So that's if you get very high speed.
No, because of the light fall off and the distance is there for the light to fall off and die before it hits something and reflects back.
But I mean, then you have to go on manual and the shutter speed.
You have to adjust it. Yeah, you have to adjust fast. Not on TTL.
Shutter speed is not the factor there. Basically, if your exposure is completely on the light that you create on your speed light or the flash, no other light is coming anyways now, even in daytime. So if the flashlight is dying off before it hits another subject behind your subject, it will look dark. So in studios also, Sam, we use it when we have the background. We don't have a black background. If the background is something like a gray background or another darker color, it's easier to just let the light die off before it hits the background.
Correct. You can try it, Mahin. Try dialing in 1/200th of a second shutter speed, ISO 100, and maybe about 11 or 16 aperture, and take a picture during the daytime and see what comes out. Keep making your aperture as small as possible to just get a completely black picture. If you can get that, if you add a flash or another light, then the exposure is going to be only through that additional lighting that you are going to add to the picture, not from your normal exposure. Try that and see. Did you understand? Did you get what I meant?
Yes, I got that.
Because
actually before this lesson earlier when I used to take pictures, when I wanted to edit everything dark, I used to make sure it was in the night that I took the pictures.
Okay.
Home is complaining, I'm switching off all the lights.
After
I learned from you all the other day, those pictures I took it in the daytime by doing.
They were very nice, sir. They were very nice.
I tried something and then I was able to get it dark. Sorry, one more question I keep asking. Now, I'm just looking at my flash. Now, I was for 1 year plus, I had the flash. I should just put on TT and keep shooting things. But recently, only after that, I started this manual and then going one, you know, reducing the power to get these effects. What is this multi thing? Where would you use multi? Where would you use manual? Where would you use TTL? Yeah.
Right. TTL is when you use it on complete auto mode. You don't worry about the power output from the flash. You put it on to TTL mode. Flash and the camera communicates with each other. And then the flash will be commanded to give the required power output to get the correct exposure. Okay. That's
auto mode forward. Means automate of the camera, is it?
No. Even in the manual mode of your camera, you can put it on to TTL. Camera is on TTL. The flash is on TTL.
Yeah. And the flash is what?
Flash, you can get from one full power to, we'll say, 1/64th of power, 1/32nd of your power output in the manual mode in your flash.
Yes.
There's a range.
Yes. Now,
unless you go into the manual mode and set it, you don't know what to dial in. So in the TTL mode, what it does this pre-flash and the calculations are done and the command is given by the camera to the flash to give 1/32nd or 1/16th or 1/8th or whatever the power requirement to light up the subject. Right. So that's an automatic mode. It's called the TTL or the ETTL mode. In the manual mode, you have to decide what amount of power to be given out. The third one is actually you give a command based on a few factors. The flash is going to emit flashes in one go, but at particular intervals, right? It's not going to be a continuous flash, or you don't see one flash. It's going to be flashing at several intervals, several times. But you have to tell the camera how many flashes are required, how much time duration is required for the subject. And the subject is not going to be a stationary subject. In these cases, what you want to capture is a movement, but that movement is going to be captured not in several frames, but in single frame. So in a single frame, you have a longer duration shutter speed. Flashes are going to occur at multiple situations at a certain frequency or certain time intervals, and you're going to end up with one single image with the subject moving. Now the picture
Mitra took showed, smoking. No?
Exactly. The lady was
okay,
moving.
Okay.
The
right,
lady was
now
moving
I get it.
And while
okay.
just she was moving, the flash went off.
Right. Now I got it.
Yeah. There was something, you know, when you said that you are doing photography in the night, completely dark area, something that you're going to struggle with is the focusing.
Yes.
Right? You're not sure where you're going to focus and where it is focusing.
Yeah, so, I used to hold the phone torch and all those things.
So one trick that you can do, if you have a tripod, keep your camera on the tripod, put your lights on, focus where you want to focus, and then switch off the autofocus. Then you're on manual focus. Focusing is not going to shunt or move. It's fixed. Then you do whatever else that you want to do. Knock your lights off and do whatever that has to be done.
When you say fix the focus, that means you press the trigger halfway.
No. You can manually focus or you
manually.
Okay,
and then right. yeah,
manually focus
yeah, yeah,
and
yeah,
do it.
Okay,
leave
okay.
it at manual. Then the okay. focus is not going to shunt.
And sorry, one last question. Now
keep on asking, no worries.
No. Sorry, because this flash has been this thing. Now, when it comes to just now, I understood reducing them, you know, all these modes and all that. Now, when it comes to taking the birthday party or just a, you know, social event, then I used to just put TTL and bounce it off whatever white ceiling and all this from the little I knew. That situation, a function or an event, is it what is the better mode? Is it manual or is it TTL or what?
If you are going to keep moving and the subjects are keeping moving, it's one of the most difficult things to handle. So the TTL, in my opinion, TTL bouncing off somewhere is the easiest and the fastest way of doing it. But if you are pretty sure of your settings and the lighting levels, after you take one shot, you know what kind of lighting is required in that particular, the angle or setting that you are in. Once you dial it in, you can go on. Otherwise, TTL.
So most event photographers actually use TTL these days.
Yeah.
When they're doing run and gun kind of shoots around the venues and all.
So what I do, Mahin, is that I have been taking some wedding photographs and things like that. I actually bounce flash, and I use the white dome on the flash gun. That way I diffuse the flash. Then I actually manual on the camera. So I set it up around about 1/80th of a second, and then do a few test shots with the aperture round about 8 or something like that until I get a reasonable good exposure. Then you take the photographs, and generally they come out okay.
Sam,
I don't even leave there.
Yeah, Mitra was going to say something.
Sam, some of the photographers, what they do is they set the flash power to about 1/4 of a second, and they know at what distance the flash will work best. So you have to be mindful at what distance you are on, and then they click at that distance. So they keep a flash power at 1/4. The problem is, if you want TTL, you have to be careful on the background also. If there's a glass in the background, if it's dark, those things also happen. So some of the professionals, what they do, they work on manual and carefully judge the distance where the subject is and use the flash. So it knows it's that amount of flash that you go to that distance. So it's a... I also do that sometimes, and I find it better than using TTL sometimes, like especially if there's a fire coming up, that kind of thing, the flash will not read that. You know, flash will give a different reading. So you have to be careful what level of flash that you go to that point.
Because what happens with TTL is that it's trying to set the exposure to 17% gray overall.
Yeah.
Like if you have a white background and if you immediately have a black background, the TTL might get confused and sometimes over or underexpose your subject.
Yeah. Most of the time, actually, the first shot is not the correct shot, no? If you're on TTL, because the camera is trying to gauge the settings, and then the second shot onwards only works. Kanta, you have been very quiet. Kanta, any questions? George?
Yes, Sam, I have one question.
I was
waiting till all the experts finished.
Your line is breaking.
I use this speed light 270X,
yes.
I use the Canon.
Yes.
Speed light 270EX2. Hello.
Yes. Yeah.
What I want to know is, Sam, whether I can use the TTL with the camera. Does it have?
Yeah, it has.
Because I'm not used. Yeah, sure.
Your line is breaking.
I just used it as a flash, but not as a remote.
No, TTL is actually when your flash is on your camera, or connected via another device.
My signal is not good, looks like.
Yeah, your signal is not good.
Can you hear me now?
Oh, okay, it's better now.
Yes. Uh-huh. Right.
Line is breaking up.
The Canon 270 EX2.
Yes.
I will put it onto the group. No more. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah, right, thanks.
So one of the things that, maybe that came out of this discussion also, somebody said about taking photographs outside as well. And the one of the modes in these flash guns, and one of the things that we have done previously, is balance lighting. So that is balancing the flash lighting together with the ambient. Now, maybe today is not the time to talk about it. Perhaps another day we can actually devote to balance lighting. It's a very interesting thing to actually get rid of harsh shadows and such light.
Sure.
And,
another thing, can I point out? When you're shooting outside, if you're on a higher shutter speed, you will be certainly using the high sync flash. So the level of high sync flash it consumes more battery power, and the power of light, you need to get much closer to the subject. So you have to be mindful of that factor. The battery power goes down, the power of the flash power, the flash power needs more power. So you have to be mindful when you're shooting outdoor with available light, sunlight or whatever. Ready?
Yeah, unless you use an ND filter maybe.
No. Unfortunately, I didn't talk too much about Sony cameras and Sony lenses and flashers, or Fuji for that matter. But it's basically the thinking or the technology is the same, but it's the product that is different. I think only Deanti is using Sony in this group, if I'm not mistaken. Deanti?
Yeah.
Any questions?
To ask questions, I don't know much about flashlights.
Did we at least give you some clue about what it is?
Yes, you did.
Okay.
Thanks.
Manju?
Yeah,
but
Sam.
Does actually Sony and Fuji has their own speed light variants?
Yes, they have.
Okay.
They have, and the third parties also, as I showed earlier, they also have the variants for the different brands. You have to be very careful, as I said, in selecting the correct one.
Right.
Sam, I think there's a question from Yoga on the chat.
Suppose if we want to do night street photography with no flashlights, what advice can you give? Well,
open up the shutter as the aperture as much as possible.
Well, anyway, I don't recommend the flash to be used in street photography because you might get hammered by somebody.
When you're doing
street photography, one of the fundamental things is that you have to be inobtrusive. You shouldn't be seen as taking a picture, and you have to take a moment which is a fleeting moment captured without the subject knowing about it. So the moment you point a flash, you get exposed immediately. So the answers are: open up your aperture, increase or slow down your shutter speed to the maximum that you can, and ISO comes to the rescue thereafter.
So we actually experienced this during the last night street photography experience, right? Relevantly new members who joined had the camera on the auto mode, and the flash came up. And like everybody was looking at the whole group, like all of a sudden, because we were just stealthily taking photographs without being noticed. This really happened at Valavata station.
Talking about that, there are two things that one of my advice for street photographers is what the very first thing that you should do when you get the camera is to knock off that focus light, because the focus light is a dead giveaway.
Not the focus.
That that white light that comes on the camera. So knock that off from the menu. So, and the other thing that that I have been working with my cameras is that on the ISO, there's a very interesting feature. Generally, I set it at one ISO and actually just take the photographs depending on whether it is night or whatever. But these new ones, I don't know the new ones, but mine is a 71-200. You can set the ISO range between the lowest the highest. You can limit it.
Auto
and
ISO.
Depending, you said auto ISO, but it doesn't just go all the way to the top where it becomes utterly useless. So it actually stays within a range that you specify. And then the camera actually decides, depending on the shutter speed that you've chosen and the aperture, which ISO to choose, which is quite useful. I learned that from one of the wildlife photographers that came on one of the meetings.
Yeah. In fact, on the Fuji, I think there are three different settings that you can have.
Yeah. So
three different ranges.
Yes.
Range one, range two, range three sort of thing, so that it can stretch. You can just switch it on. Manju, I think you were trying to say something.
Thank you, Sam. And thank you, Kaumini, for the presentation and all your explanations. I'm really not a very technical person when it comes. I don't use flashes very much, even though I do have one. So I have been taking notes now while the presentation was going on. I will slowly process all that information and hopefully do something. I realize now my shoot that I put up on the group, I realized that perhaps the light was a little too harsh. Like what you said, you had to use a diffuser to soften the light, and the shadows were too harsh perhaps. So I might redo that and, you know, taking suggestions from your presentation. And like Mahin said, I also was doing in the night, you know, like putting all the lights off and doing, but I have been doing one thing right, which you said, which was to put all the lights on and then focus on your subject and then put the lights off and take the photos. I'm glad I did something right.
We learn every day. So
yeah.
I think these sessions are helping all of us to share our knowledge and become better photographers, I think.
Sam, I have a small suggestion, right? This inherent idea that hard light is bad light, right? There's no bad light. So depending on the creative requirement, maybe we can discuss when to use hard light, when to use soft light, when to use specular light, and when to use diffused light. So there is a big difference between soft light and diffused light. We need to understand that also.
Sure.
So the opposite of hard light is soft light. That is true. The opposite of diffuse light is not hard light. It's specular light. So we need to understand the difference and when to use them creatively as well. That helps a lot.
Yep, sure.
There's another session.
There's another session.
Thanks, Sandeep, for that. That's good. That's a good
point. In fact, if you look at Mitra's photography, and I think to a great extent yours as well, there's a lot of hard lighting coming in, isn't it? Mitra uses fair amount, though it is softened, but I think there is a lot of specularity in the pictures.
Yeah, I think across Honeycomb makes it it gives a diffuse effect when it comes through, but it doesn't spread. It's a unusual way of light coming in. Sam, Nilan, another thing.
Just a moment. Yeah, Mitra, one moment. Nilan, you were trying to say something earlier. I'll come back to you, Mitra.
No.
I thought you wanted to say something. Any questions or clarifications, Nilan?
No, I use flash for macro photography, the ring flash.
Ring flash, okay.
Most of the time.
Right. And
that's another case where, Sam, we cut the ambient and use the flash to stop the camera shake even. yeah. because the flash is gonna give a very fast exposure.
Sure.
Sam.
Yes, Manju.
I was trying to get the rim light.
Okay.
But I couldn't work it out. If you could just.
Rim light, rim, R-I-M, rim.
Yeah, you know, like when yes. the subject, most of the subject is in darkness, but you know, you just get this bright outline.
Yeah, it's a bit of a tricky thing. You have to do a bit of trial and error and do it. If you saw what Mitra showed the other day, what he used was a bare flashlight behind the subject, hidden but pointing towards the subject, so that when you take the picture, the outline comes out because the light is actually just brushing along the subject's outer. So it's
that's what I wanted, just brushing.
Yeah. So just you have to keep it behind the subject, bare flashlight, and angling of the light also is it also matters to avoid any sudden areas that are going to get lit too much.
From the background, usually at a 45 degree angle towards the subject from the background. That's what we use for photography when we want to create rim light.
And you'd have to use like how Mitra used like a sort of a cylinder to direct the light, is it?
Yeah,
not necessarily.
Not necessarily.
For my shoot, Sam, I used a conical snoot, right?
That's for a hair light mostly, na? Just to outline.
So this one has a bigger spread, yeah. Actually. This snoot has a bigger spread. So I used it to create that rim altogether. And I removed the honeycomb out of it.
Honeycomb.
The honeycomb was stopping it from spilling around me.
Okay. Yeah. Yoga is asking a question. What is a rim light? And what Nilan was talking about, it is actually not a rim light, it is a ring light, circular light, used for your macro photography. He wants to know what the brand is. Naomi, you are using a V860 light flash,
yes.
Isn't it?
Yes.
Version 1 or version 2?
2.
Yeah, even the version 2, I would suggest. Mm-hmm. Because it has a built-in rechargeable lithium-ion battery.
Correct.
If you charge it and don't use it, continuously, regularly,
yeah.
Pull the battery out because it might bulge out if you just leave it.
Okay. Right.
The first version had that problem, but I don't know whether the second version also has the same issue.
Yeah.
But to be on the safe side, if you charge it fully, don't leave it in the flash itself, because if it bulges out, it's very difficult to pull it out.
Okay. I think if I'm not mistaken, it's out. Anyways, I'm planning on pulling it out tomorrow to do something. So thank you for that, Sam. Yes.
Sam, I wanted to show something to Yoga. So
go ahead, please.
Yeah.
Yoga.
Thank you.
This is the ring light.
Yeah.
The rim light is basically around your subject. There is an outline kind of a thing appearing, a bright outline kind of a thing.
Mitra, I interrupted you. You were going to say something.
Yeah, Sam, you know, I came across a situation like, say, it's a stage play and you're far away, right?
Okay.
I notice if I boost up the ISO and use the flash, right, at the highest power, it goes to that point. Normally, we say the flash doesn't go that far or whatever, but the flash works up to the stage if you boost the ISO. That means, I don't know whether it...
No, it is, the light will still, go, but it keeps on dying.
Yeah.
The further away it goes from the flash.
Yeah.
When you boost the ISO, what happens is the limited light that is coming back to the sensor is processed better than at a lower ISO.
So actually you can take at a distance, even use the flash with the higher
in certain situations you can bump up the ISO and take use the flash.
Mitra, yeah. This is Laya here. I have actually done that. There are two or three tricks that you can use with the flash gun. Now, if you actually connect the flash gun to the camera, and if you are using a long lens, like for example, I did the 100 millimeter, 200 millimeter,
yeah.
Most of these flash guns has a flash head that effectively narrows the beam down to the 200 millimeter so that it shoots further.
Yeah.
So for now, I showed the jazz festivals, whenever I should take the photographs, I actually use that. Now, you can also have off camera the flash, and you can dial up the zoom effect to 200 millimeter, 50
yeah.
millimeter or whatever, so that you can actually restrict the spread of the angle. So the narrower the angle, further the light output is.
Yeah. Well, something else, Laya.
Oh, that's right.
You got to be careful. If you have this panel,
yeah.
If you pull it out,
yeah,
you automatically lock your zoom to the widest
right.
position.
Now, this
goes from 24 to 105 or something.
Yeah.
The moment I pull it out, it locks at 24.
Locks
it
up.
Can't go beyond that, even right. in manual mode. So you have to be careful. Sometimes you without knowing, you pull it out and then try to zoom. You have to be careful with that as well.
Yeah, that's something that I experimented with because of the single light photography that we were going to do last, couple of weeks. I dialed that is why the light was so harsh. I dialed the thing to the zoom setting of 200 millimeter and put that diffuser back in. So naturally it comes up very harsh.
Okay.
Right.
Yes.
Any other questions? Yes.
This one. What I want to ask is now, like you said, where would you use now? My flash came with this normal white whatever thing to diffuse the light, and it came with that pop out thing which you showed.
Yes.
Situations would you use either one?
Right. Now the cover that you showed, the plastic cover.
Yeah.
That's a kind of a soft. It makes it softer because it is going through another kind of a diffuser kind of a thing.
Yeah.
Instead of the white that we have on the soft boxes,
right.
You're putting this plastic thing and making it a little bit softer. But it also will cut down the amount of light that comes through. There are two types of pull-out things here.
Yes.
One is this white color thing.
Yeah.
Okay. White is used when you have your camera on, the flash on your camera, and you're bouncing it off the ceiling.
Right.
Okay. You pull this out and then flash. The idea is, now if you don't have this, the light goes up and comes down and lights up your subject.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
But the subject's eyes and the and these areas are not going to be lit adequately because it's coming down.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Mm-hmm. What this does is it reflects a little bit of light onto the subject's face if it's a person.
Right.
And also the more important thing is it gives a catch light.
Mm-hmm.
The catch light is seen in the eye. Now, if you don't see the catch light in the eye, people tend to assume. No, if you see the eye, is normally lit. There's a reflection through the eye.
Mm-hmm.
So this reflection of the panel helps us to get that catch light and makes the person live.
Right. Okay.
Okay. That is one. The second one is actually to Laya was talking about zooming.
Mm-hmm.
This head also has a zooming capability.
Okay.
The position of the lamp moves up and down internally.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
Okay, by pushing it down further and further, what it does is it narrows the beam and makes it go further away. So
further away. Okay.
Like what you're zooming your lens. So when the panel is pulled out, the white panel, it locks it at 24 and it disperses the light.
Mm-hmm.
So these are the two different ways of using it.
Right, okay, thank you.
Right. Any other questions? Santosh, good to see you. You've been very quiet.
Hi, sir. I'm just following it. Completely new sort of subject to me. So
yeah.
Trying to sort of start small and then slowly develop into it. Yeah, appreciating all what you're doing regarding this sparked a huge interest in my sort of knowledge and sort of.
I really like your first set of images. Huh? It was beautiful.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Right. Laya, anything to add?
Thank you very much. And this was fantastic. I mean, it's a good one and I think it's useful for many. So that spawned out two other talks, one on balanced lighting and the other one, as Sandeep said, different grades of lighting. And okay. Actually, get Varna to use the flash gun now.
So I don't even have a flash.
Well, buy one.
He almost did today, I think.
I almost did, but then I held back.
Yes, thanks, Sam and Kaumini. That was really great.
Good. So we look forward to more pictures coming from the group on the forum.
Yeah, I'm going to use the Ceylon tea cup and see what happens.
Try it and see. I'm sure it will come out well. Okay. Unless there's any other questions, thank you very much for joining. And
thank you.
Thanks, Naomi, for hosting us as usual.
By the way,
Naomi's kitchen is open for orders now.
If I may hijack this meeting, there are many of the here, and I don't know how many of you know that the PSSL gallery is open now. So all of these photographs, nice photographs that you guys are taking, do take the opportunity to put them into the showcase and showcase your wares. So that is on behalf of Hiran.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thanks, everyone.
And if there's any question, please keep asking.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks. Thank you.
Good night.